He's one bad motherfucker.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Jimmy Dore Show. I'm here with one of my favorite writers, great journalist, Adam Johnson. He writes for Fair, Fairness, and Accuracy in Reporting, and also for Alternet. Now, you might know him because he was the one who caught the Washington Post writing 16 negative articles. And how many hours was it? 16 different negative articles on Bernie Sanders. That was when I first really became aware of this gentleman. How are you, Adam?
I'm well. How are you?
I'm doing great. So tell me, how did that come about that you caught the Washington Post doing that? Now, everybody quotes that article you did, and everybody quotes your research. How did you come about that?
Oh, I don't know. I suppose I just read a lot. I noticed the general tenor of coverage from the Washington Post was pretty predictably anti-Sanders, and I noticed on that day, which incidentally was my birthday, that there had been a kind of more than usual amount of negativity. Now, it was right before the primary, if you recall, in Michigan, I think, where Sanders ended up winning by surprise. So I noticed that there was, in the build-up to that, what appeared to me to be a you know, I don't know if it's coordinated, but I definitely think there was something said in some editing room or editor's room where they said, guys, you know, this Bernie guy's gotten it too easy. Let's put the heat, you know, let's turn the heat up. That wouldn't surprise me. So, it seemed like the coverage kind of ballooned that day. And so I noted it.
You don't think that could happen accidentally. You know, I was talking with Thomas Frank, the author of Listen Liberal. And he made the same point. He said, you know, I've been reading the Washington Post. These are all the same people who have been writing. And all of a sudden, they started writing all these articles negative against Bernie Sanders. And it surprised him, too. So, you don't
think the piece that Thomas Frank did in Harper's about the Washington Post, their coverage of Sanders, I actually helped him do research on that.
Oh, okay.
And it was, you know, he's way, way, way more like, you know, he's very, prudent. He's not someone who throws around allegations without doing like really exhaustive research, and he really, really did his research in that piece. I did like a fraction of what it ultimately ended up in the piece, but I mean, the tenor of the Washington Post during the primaries was, I think, quite clearly in favor of Clinton and very anti-Sanders, both on the editorial side and the straight reporting side, and also the op-ed side. Now they do have like their token, you know, pro-Sanders pundit in residency, but general, I would say the vast majority was fairly negative, and it got more negative as certain primaries were approaching.
So now, what do you think that reflects? What is that a symptom of?
I mean, look, Jeff Bezos doesn't give, you know, $250 million to Trotskyite newspapers. You know, he doesn't give $250 million to like newspapers that are going to meaningfully subvert his bottom line. This is true across the board of corporate media. Now, the Washington Post was very centrist and very corporate before Bezos bought it in 2013, so you know, a lot of it's just part of the DNA of the paper itself. But, you know, the Post is an establishment institution. It's there to protect the interest of, I mean, predominantly national security, right? National security establishment is kind of their go-to. For the longest time, you know, the Washington Post, you know, in the 50s and 60s, I had very close relationships with the CIA, with the FBI, and that's just part of the DNA of the paper. It's the editorial line has always been very, I guess you could say, I hate to use the word establishment because it is kind of vague, but I don't know what other term to use in this context. So it doesn't necessarily surprise me that would be their MO when it came to the primaries. And I think most neutral observers, even if they don't like Sanders, would probably agree with that. I don't think that's a very controversial claim.
So why do you think someone like Jeff Bezos, who I describe on this show as a predatory capitalist who has a $600 million deal with the CIA to store all their data, so why would he also want to own the paper, newspaper of note? What do you think is in it for him to do that?
I don't know. I think that we did an analysis of the Washington Post coverage of Bezos last week. We actually found that it wasn't any better than the Times and the Wall Street Journal. It was almost all uniformly positive. The percent of favorable articles to Bezos from neutral to favorable in all three publications was roughly 92 to 94%. Now the reason that is because most tech journalism is very sycophantic. It's very access driven, even more so than normal journalism. I think tech journalism, because of Bezos is sort of generically tech, he falls under that radar. That there isn't much meaningful criticism. There hasn't been an in-depth investigative report into Bezos in all three of those publications since August of 2015. So, you know, I don't know. I don't know what maybe has sinister motives for owning the Post. I don't know. But they were very conservative and very establishment before he bought them. So I don't necessarily know if there's much of a difference. But I do know that, you know, again, billionaires don't invest in, I generally don't think, invest in publications that are meaningfully subversive. Now, of course, the Washington Post does occasionally do good stuff. I don't want to say they don't. But broadly speaking, yeah, it's pretty by the numbers, especially its political reporting.
Hey, everybody, the next live Jimmy Dore show is August 16th. That's a Wednesday, new time, 9 p.m. 9 p.m. show, August 16th in Burbank, California. Get your tickets right there or at JimmyDoreComedy.com.